Welcome to the 25th lecture in the course Engineering Electromagnetics. In this lecture, we continue with our discussion on parallel plane guide. The specific topics we take up today are transverse magnetic waves, the field distribution for the transverse magnetic waves, and the expression of these fields in terms of plane waves. The parallel plane guide structure that we have been considering is the following. It consists of infinite conducting planes placed at x equal to 0 and at x equal to a. For the perfect dielectric region between these two conductors, we have written down Maxwell's equations earlier and processed these so that we obtain expressions for the transverse field components Hx, Hy and Ex, Ey in terms of the longitudinal field components Ez and Hz. From these expressions, we make out that in general, one of these Ez or Hz must be non-zero. And we considered earlier the case of transverse electric waves where Ez is 0, and today we go on to consider the case when Hz is 0, corresponding to the case of transverse magnetic waves. There is no magnetic field component along the direction of propagation, hence the name transverse magnetic. We start with the let us identify which field components exist in this case. Hz is 0, Ez is non-zero, and therefore we have Ex, Hy and of course Ez as the non-zero field components. Let us note down this. For the TM waves, the field components that are non-zero are the following. We have Hz equal to 0, and of course we have Ez as a non-zero field component, and then as we identified earlier, we have Ex and also Hy. Out of 6 possible field components, we have 3 field components which are non-zero, just as in the case of the transverse electric waves. We consider the wave equation for the electric field, okay, and we write down the component of this wave equation for the z component of the electric field, because that is what is going to be tangential to the perfectly conducting planes, and therefore it will be possible for us to apply the boundary conditions in a simple manner. And therefore, we write down the wave equation for the z component of the electric field as follows. Del 2 Ez by del x squared plus gamma bar squared Ez, which should be equal to minus omega squared mu epsilon Ez. From the vector wave equation for the electric field, we pick up the z component, all right, for the reason already explained. Then we consider the nature of the z component of the electric field, and realizing that Ez is equal to a part which varies with respect to x, which we call EZ naught x, and a part which varies with z in this manner by virtue of our assumption that it propagates in the z direction with the propagation constant gamma bar. We realize that this second order partial differential equation can be written as a second order ordinary differential equation for this part of EZ. Processing this equation, therefore, we get del 2 EZ by del x squared equal to minus h squared EZ, where the symbol h was introduced earlier also, and it stands for omega squared mu epsilon plus gamma bar squared. And then by substituting for EZ this expression, we can see easily that it reduces to d 2 EZ naught by dx squared, which should be equal to minus h squared EZ naught. As far as the part which varies with respect to x is concerned, it satisfies this simple second order differential equation, the solution for which can be written by inspection. We obtain EZ naught equal to, let us say, C 3 sin of h x, h is the parameter we have written down earlier, plus C 4 cosine of h x. As already noted, E z is a field component which is tangential to the perfectly conducting surfaces constituting the parallel plane guide, and therefore it should be 0 at x equal to 0, implying that C 4 must be 0, and since it must be 0 also at x equal to a, we get the value of the parameter h as before as h equal to m pi by a, m taking on values in general 1, 2, 3, etcetera. While in the case of TE waves, m equal to 0 would have led to a trivial situation, all field components becoming 0. In the TM case, it does not happen. This we shall discuss in detail later on. So, while m equal to 0 is not ruled out, for TM waves, we will restrict ourselves to the choice that m varies from 1, 2, 3, etcetera. All right. And therefore, the complete expression for EZ becomes EZ naught x, which is C 3 sin of m pi by a x e to the power minus gamma bar z. Okay. Once we have obtained the expression for E z, the expressions for the other field components which are non-zero in this case, that is E x and H y, can be obtained from the equations shown earlier, since all field components are related through the Maxwell's equations. So, taking up that, we can write down the complete expressions for the TM M0 modes corresponding to different values of the index m, the role of which was explained last time. We obtain the following field expressions. EZ, of course, as we had already written down, is C 3 sin of m pi by a x e to the power minus gamma bar z. The other field components which are non-zero are Ex, which is minus gamma bar A by m pi times C 3 cosine of m pi by A x e to the power minus gamma bar z. And finally, we have h y, which is minus j omega epsilon a by m pi and C 3 times cosine of m pi by a x e to the power minus gamma bar z. As we discussed last time, in this case when we are not considering the presence of any kind of losses, gamma bar, the propagation constant, which in general is complex, in this case is either completely real or completely imaginary. We are interested in the situation in the range of frequencies where gamma bar is completely imaginary usually, and therefore considering that and considering the expression for the fields for m equal to 1, that is TM 10 mode, under the situation that gamma bar goes to j beta bar, which happens above a certain frequency. We can rewrite these expressions as follows. We have E z equal to C 3 sine of m pi by a x, and then followed by e to the power minus j beta bar z, indicating wave propagation in the z direction with the phase shift constant beta bar with no attendant attenuation. Similarly, the other field components become E x equal to, since this is for m equal to 1, we need not have written this. Similarly, E x becomes minus j beta bar a by pi and then C 3 cosine of pi by a x e to the power minus j beta bar z. And similarly, h y becomes minus j omega epsilon a by pi, and a similar expression as E x. So, C 3 times cosine of pi by a x e to the power minus j beta bar z. Okay. This is the nature, this is the exact expression for the fields for TM 10 mode in the frequency range when the propagation constant gamma bar is completely imaginary, and therefore its magnitude is equal to the phase shift constant for this type of wave. Now, to understand the nature of these fields better, we consider the corresponding time varying expressions by multiplying these field components by e to the power j omega t and taking the real part. Carrying out that procedure leads to the following time varying field expressions for this particular mode, and of course they can be obtained for any other mode in general, and we get E z equal to C 3 sine of pi a by x and then cosine of omega t minus beta z. Okay. As actually the field components are a function of both time and z, both are sinusoidal. Similarly, the other field expressions turn out to be E x equal to beta bar a by pi c 3 cosine of pi by a x, and then here we are going to have sine of omega t minus beta bar z. Okay, and h y becomes omega epsilon a by pi c 3 cosine of pi by a x sine of omega t minus beta bar z, which are the time varying field expressions for the TM10 wave. And as we did for the case of the transverse electric waves, for the transverse magnetic waves also we can now consider the nature of the fields. In a similar manner, we have got the skeleton of the parallel plane waveguide marked here. As far as the magnetic field is concerned, now in this case that is the one which has a single component. So let us deal with that first. That is a y component, and therefore we consider an xy plane kind of cross section of the parallel plane guide. That is, at some z equal to constant plane we consider the cross section. Okay. Of course, the actual value of h y will depend upon the actual value of z and the actual time instant chosen. Let us say that we choose omega t minus beta bar z such that it is pi by 2, so that it drops out of consideration, and in that case h y can be plotted. Okay. And we can continue with our convention that values with positive sign are represented to the right of the reference line, and the values with negative sign are represented to the left of the reference plane. So, following that convention, at x equal to a by 2, these are the locations of the planes, the field is 0. It is maximum at the planes, and it may be represented by a cosine function like this. Okay, at x equal to a, it is a negative value, so it is represented to the left of the reference plane. And as we have been saying, we may visualize this field in a plane normal to the plane that is being shown here. Okay, and positive values may be coming out of this plane, negative values may be going down this plane. Okay. So, this is the representation in magnitude, and as we know it can be represented in an alternative manner in magnitude and direction by using the directed line segment kind of representation. And that is going to look like this. In the same plane, that is x y plane cross section, x is 0 and a here and a by 2 here, and we must draw line segments which are oriented in the negative y direction, taking care of this sign, and are closely spaced here towards the conducting plane. And then as we go down towards the center of the waveguide, the spacing increases considerably. Actually, right at the center the field is 0, there must not be any line drawn there. Similarly, the other side can be completed in a symmetric manner, okay, and the arrow sign must be reversed, remaining consistent with our sign convention, okay. In this case, the magnetic field representation is relatively simpler, since the magnetic field is now composed of a single component. It is a y directed magnetic field, and it can be represented in these two alternative fashions. Taking up the electric field next, which has two field components and therefore is going to require a little more care. We have the components of the electric field, which are x and z, and therefore we choose to show this in the x z planes. And the locations of these planes remain as already indicated here at x equal to 0 and at x equal to a. Then we mark a number of reference planes, which are essentially the values of omega t minus beta bar z, and we can choose these values as pi, pi by 2, 0, and minus pi by 2, etcetera. This argument will decrease as the values of z increase. Now, at omega t minus beta bar z equal to pi, out of the two components E x and E z, E x is going to be 0, only E z is going to be non-zero, okay, and also this part of this expression is going to have a value minus 1, otherwise it will have a sinusoidal variation from x equal to 0 to x equal to a. So, with these observations we can now plot E z in this manner. This becomes E z. And with similar observations, if we were to plot the fields at this plane where omega t minus beta bar z is equal to 0, once again only E z will be present and the sign will be reversed, and therefore it can be shown by a curve which looks like this. At the other planes where the argument is pi by 2 or minus pi by 2, only E x will have a value, non-zero value, E z will be 0 as far as these exact values are concerned. And keeping our sign convention, E x is going to have a cosinusoidal variation like this at this plane, and the sign is going to change at the other plane, so that it can be represented in this manner, okay. So, this is a representation in magnitude. The direction does not come out very clearly in this kind of representation. This limitation can be overcome by going in for the representation in terms of directed line segments, as we did for the TE case also. and we have this as the xz plane, and at omega t minus beta bar z equal to pi, only Ez is non-zero. Okay, and as we move away from this reference plane, the value decreases. So, keeping these things in mind, we can show this as follows. This kind of line segments, all right, and what arrow direction will we put? It is a negative sign here following our convention, and therefore, it should be directed in this manner. As we move away from this middle plane, the value decreases, and therefore, as we move in either direction, the spacing of the arrows should increase. Also, as we move away from this reference plane along the z direction, once again this field component is going to decrease in value, and while at exactly this reference plane Ex was 0, as we shift from this reference plane, Ex will assume increasingly non-zero values. So, keeping these things in mind, we increase the spacing of the arrows in this manner, and we also do not draw these with the same length. Okay. Actually, this is also an idealization. As far as the z directed field component is concerned, it exists alone only at this reference plane. As we shift from this, x component does come in with increasing value, and therefore, there will be an appropriate curvature of these field lines. So, keeping that in mind, we do not draw these with the same length, and of course, the spacing is increasing. All right. Similarly, one may complete this part here, since this has already been discussed and is going to follow exactly the same arguments. The only change will be the reversal of the arrow signs, otherwise it is an identical pattern. Here we had negatively z directed field lines, and here we have field lines directed in the positive z direction. Okay. Now, the same procedure is applied to the x component of the electric field. At these planes, that is pi by 2 and minus pi by 2, Ez is completely 0, and Ex has the strongest value close to the planes. At the midpoint, Ex also is 0, and therefore, we can draw x directed lines here, which are closely spaced. This is in the negative x direction, recognizing our sign convention, and this is in the positive x direction. Okay. And then the spacing must increase for these lines as we shift from this reference plane, and we also reduce the length, recognizing that z component is going to appear as we shift from this reference plane, and therefore, we may draw the field lines for Ex in this manner here, and similarly in this manner at these locations. As far as drawing these lines at the corresponding plane minus pi by 2 is concerned, it is now a simple matter. We repeat the pattern and change the arrow signs, and therefore, we get a pattern which looks like this. Okay, with the arrow signs reversed. And similarly, here and here, this is the kind of skeleton of the complete field lines that we have drawn. And once we have reached this stage, it should be fairly clear that actually the field lines have this kind of shape. And if we have proceeded correctly, following our convention of sign consistently, the arrow directions will come out compatible. And if there is a clash, that is an indication that a mistake has been made somewhere, either in converting the converting from the phasor notation to the time varying notation, or in translating the time varying field components into this kind of curves. But if we proceed correctly, carefully, we will get this kind of field patterns consistently. There are textbooks where this kind of field plots are given for a number of modes. Here we have done it only for TM10 mode and earlier for the TE10 mode. All right. Now, when we look at these field components, and earlier also we have made comments that the nature of the propagation constant is changing as a function of frequency. It would appear that the waves that we are dealing with now, that are supported on the parallel plane guide, are different in nature from the uniform plane waves, the TEM waves that we considered earlier. In some respects these are different, but one can look at it in an alternative manner and see the link between the uniform plane waves and the TE or TM waves that we are dealing with now. Let us consider the parallel plane guide and try and recall the fields for the TE10 mode. Specifically, we are now taking up the topic of expressing these field components as a superposition of plane waves. Alternatively, one could also call it plane wave decomposition of the waveguide fields. We consider the fields for the TE10 mode, which had field components EY, HX and HZ. Let us consider the expression for the EY field component. It was in terms of an amplitude constant, say C1, sine of, let us make it general, let us not restrict it to m equal to 1 mode. We make it TEM0 mode, so that we write here sine of m pi by a x, okay, and then we will write here e to the power minus gamma bar z in general, but let us consider this in the frequency range when gamma bar goes to j beta bar, so that the exponential factor that we get here is e to the power minus j beta bar z, where if you look at the expressions, beta bar will come out to be omega squared mu epsilon minus m pi by a whole squared and the square root of the entire expression. And for beta bar to be real, omega should be greater than a certain value, which we shall comment upon a little later. All right. Now, if we look at the two parts of the field expression, one giving the variation with respect to z, that is the quite similar to the wave propagation that we considered earlier, except for the fact that the phase shift constant is now beta bar, which is different from the phase shift constant expression that we had for the propagation in an infinite medium. Okay. As far as the variation with respect to the x direction is concerned, it appears to be similar to that of a standing wave, okay, being sinusoidal in nature. All right. So, let us develop this expression further and see what kind of interpretations are possible and how we link it to the standing wave kind of situation along the x direction. We write this as C 1, and the sine expression is written in terms of summation or difference of exponentials. So, that it is 1 by 2 j, and then we have e to the power j m pi by a x minus e to the power minus j m pi by a x multiplied by e to the power minus j beta bar z. All right. We multiply through and get C 1 by 2 j and then e to the power minus j beta bar z minus m pi by a x as far as the first term is concerned, and in the second term we get e to the power minus j beta bar z plus m pi by a x. Now, we introduce a parameter theta, the interpretation of which will become clear as we proceed. That is introduced in the following manner. We have beta bar equal to beta cos theta. Beta bar is less than beta, and let us write beta bar equal to beta cos theta, and m pi by a equal to beta times sin theta. Okay, the basis for this is not clear to us right now, but as we proceed, a very simple interpretation will become available. So, with this, we modify this to read as C 1 by 2 j, and then we have e to the power minus j beta coming out as common, and then we have cos theta z minus sin theta x as far as the first term is concerned, and the second term is quite symmetric except for a change of sign in the term terms within the bracket. So, that it is e to the power minus j beta cos theta z plus sin theta x. We further write this in the following form. It is C 1 by 2 j, and we write this as e to the power minus j beta, and let us write the position vector of a general point in the x z plane as x x cap plus z z cap, and then if we multiply this, take the dot product of this with minus sin theta x cap and plus cos theta z cap, we recover the previous expression, except that now it is in terms of the dot product of two vectors, where the first vector is the position vector of some point in the x z plane, and the second vector represents a unit vector. So, it is a certain direction in the x z plane with the direction cosines as minus sin theta and cos theta. Okay. This can be interpreted as a uniform plane wave propagating with the phase shift constant beta, not beta bar, beta, which is square root of omega square mu epsilon, the phase shift constant that one will have if the wave propagated in an infinite medium, okay, but propagating in a direction which is oblique to the z and the x direction. All right. Now, this is not alone, this is just the first term, but the second term can also be written in the same form, in a similar form, and one can have a similar interpretation also for that. It will be minus e to the power minus j beta and then x x cap plus z z cap dot sin theta x cap plus cos theta z cap, which two terms, going by the interpretation we have just offered, represent uniform plane waves with phase shift constant of a uniform plane wave, but propagating obliquely to the z direction or to the x direction. What is this direction? One can consider the parallel plane guide and consider the x z plane here, okay, this is the x equal to 0 plane and this is the x equal to a plane. Then the first term of the previous expression, if we consider its direction of propagation, is going to be represented by a ray which looks like this and is inclined to the z direction by an angle theta in this manner, and it is propagating in this direction. Okay. On the other hand, the other term represents a wave which is propagating also inclined to the z direction, but inclined in a symmetrically different direction. That is making an angle theta like this. What are the associated fields of these plane waves? We can recall the properties of the fields in the uniform plane wave, that is a transverse electric and magnetic wave. This has a y component of the electric field, let us say coming out of the plane of the blackboard, okay, and an associated magnetic field which is orthogonal to the electric field and to the direction of propagation. It is a magnetic field in the x z plane, and as you see, we have an x component of the magnetic field and a z component of the magnetic field. The vector may be represented in this manner. This is the electric field and this is the magnetic field. For the second wave, keeping in mind that there is a negative sign in front of this term, we can put down the electric field as something which is going into the plane of the blackboard, okay, and it is propagating in this direction, and therefore the magnetic field vector is going to be in this manner. And it is the superposition of these two symmetrically propagating, these two uniform plane waves propagating at an inclination to the z direction in a symmetric fashion, which constitutes the actual fields for the TE M0 mo. Now, theta here that we have got is related to the mode index m. We have sin theta equal to m pi by a times beta, and therefore, it is straightforward to make out that this angle of inclination theta is going to depend upon the index m. The mode that we choose, the value of m that we choose, will have a bearing on this inclination angle theta. Okay. For theta equal to 90 degrees, okay, which is going to happen when we have omega squared mu epsilon equal to m pi by a whole square, okay, which if you recall is the dividing line between the frequency ranges below which gamma is completely real and above which gamma bar is completely imaginary. Okay, and we see that at exactly this point theta is 90 degrees and therefore, there is really no wave motion in the positive z direction or in the z direction, and the wave just propagates back and forth with reflections at these two planes. Okay. In the x direction, the nature is that of a standing wave. We can now decompose these two plane waves into a part propagating in the x direction and a part propagating in the z direction, and the x directed components are superimposing to form a standing wave. And therefore, the spacing E must have a relationship which is quite straightforward in terms of the wavelength along the x direction. It must be equal to, let us say, m times the wavelength in the x direction divided by 2, like any standing wave. Okay, where lambda x is equal to the wavelength in free space divided by sin theta, which kind of expressions we have obtained earlier also whenever we have considered waves propagating at an inclination to an interface. All right, and therefore, here one can straight away see the phenomenon of the cutoff frequency coming into play. For a given spacing, if the wavelength in free space is so large that for the smallest value of m also this relation is not satisfied, the guide cannot support any wave propagation. So, this is where a major difference comes in propagation in infinite media and propagation in a waveguide. Since the waveguide imposes certain boundary conditions, those are satisfied only above a certain frequency range, which frequency is called the cutoff frequency and is obtained by writing omega equal to omega c, and it is going to be m pi by a divided by square root of mu epsilon, or the corresponding cutoff frequency is going to be m by 2 a divided by square root of mu epsilon. 1 by square root of mu epsilon is the velocity of light in the medium filling the parallel plane guide. Therefore, this cutoff frequency is related to that. The cutoff frequency is different for modes of different order. This is where I like to stop. If there are any questions, we can try out these. So, in the lecture today, we have considered the transverse magnetic waves for the parallel plane guide. We have seen the corresponding field distribution, and we have considered the very important concept that the waves that we are considering now, TE or TM waves, can be expressed as a superposition of plane waves. Thank you.